Hi, I'm Daniel from Craneballs, and you're listening to this rated R episode from an abandoned relic on a distant planet.
Welcome to another episode of Rated R, a Bammsters podcast.
It's episode 9! How did we manage that?
I have no idea, mate. I really have no idea. Well, I'm your host in this question, but you can call me G, and today I have the company of a man so good-looking that he needs to strap VR and AR headsets to his face just to get through the day. Yes, gentlemen, it's Booga the Looker.
Well, thank you, G. As you're all aware, I am indeed the man with the perfect face for podcasting.
You said that, not me. Well, if you're listening to this on the website, just a reminder, there's also an RSS feed for podcast clients, as well as a version for those of you of a YouTubian persuasion.
Yes, and of course, if you do listen on YouTube, please like and subscribe. It helps us. You know you want to.
Yeah, and no matter which one you're using, do leave us a comment. We will read them sooner or later. Well, for today's show, we have some news about some finance things, we have a bit of intel, and we have some gaming bits and pieces, e-Valkyrie and a little goodbye as well later on. After that, we have an interview with Daniel Maslovsky from Craneballs. He's here to talk about their Kickstarter campaign for the sci-fi sandbox survival game, Planet Nomads.
Tell me, what's new?
Well, I don't know what's new in the world, though. I do, but the big thing for me was that Bragi Dash has finally shipped. Yes.
Oh.
Or you want some as well?
I'm very, very jealous of your Bragi Dash. I really am.
Well, I would probably say that those are some Bluetooth earpieces that go inside the ear with no wires whatsoever. Pretty awesome.
Yes, and don't they do some fancy noise cancelling stuff and biometric measuring?
It does, but I think we'll do a little bit more of them once I really try them out. But for now, yeah, Europe and most of US have gotten their Kickstarter units. I hear there's a bit of headaches with some of the other areas. And you know what? I don't care because I got mine.
Like I said, I am jealous. But I shall look forward to us having a discussion about those, I think, probably in a future podcast, mate, yeah?
Yes, and I hope to have a little review of them in the near future.
Cool.
Another news that came up, you like Eve Valkyrie, right?
Oh, I love Eve Valkyrie.
Well, I know you don't yet have an Oculus Rift headset, but... Yeah, sorry, I can't help that. I can recommend checking out on February 20th. There'll be a player event, and there'll be a ton of live streams. So anybody who's curious about the game, go online, go to Twitch. Even every day I see people play, but on the 20th, I think they're going to have a large event player run where everybody's supposed to shoot everybody and do a lot of fun.
Is this basically a whole load of PC Master Race coming online on Twitch to say, look at what I've got, look at my new toy, look what you haven't got? That's what it is.
Yeah, and look at how things look once you take it out of a VR headset and apply warping or de-warping or whatever effects and putting it on Twitch.
Does that actually work?
Not too well. There's a couple of the Twitch streamers who do a really good job. I can recommend Quantum Delta. His stream looks really good. But some of them end up, to me, they look like, you remember the old green-red things for 3D?
Yeah,
it's horrible. But no, Quantum Delta, Van 5, a few others, they do a really good one.
Okay, well, you heard it here. Go catch those streams and get into the Valkyrie, I don't know, fan boy club. But I'm looking forward to that game. But I've expressed my views on not being able to get an Oculus Rift anytime soon, so I'll be waiting on another platform. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Well, anybody who wants, I think on February 20th, we will also have a little thing going. We will be hosting one of the other Twitch streamers and having a chat of general Bamsativity in our Twitch stream.
Nice.
Now, Booker, I know you've been looking at financial news.
I know, it actually seems quite sensible for one of my, somebody of my ilk. But of course, all the big tech companies are announcing their fourth quarter profits from last year. And the funny thing that caught my attention was simply that Apple, as everybody knows, basically just running away with being the most profitable company on the planet. And they actually proved that this quarter at the end of last year, where they reported essentially the biggest ever profit of any company ever in the history of companies. The funny thing was, or is that their share prices dropped. Can you believe it? And why is that, I hear you ask, Gene?
Why is that?
Simply because their growth rate wasn't quite as big as previous quarters of that year. So even though they made more money than anybody ever has ever before, because you're not growing at some crazy rate of growth, which is not sustainable on anybody's fantasy island, your prices in the share market will actually drop. I just find that laughable. But it's a true state of how our society works.
So basically, because they're not growing exponentially, they're getting punished.
Certainly their share prices is. I'm sure they're not losing too much sleep over the whole thing. If you've got revenue of $42 billion in one quarter, you're probably not too fussed about a few pence missing off your share prices. But it did make me chuckle a little bit. Obviously, a lot of the other big companies, such as Google, are also announcing profits in the last week or so for the fourth quarter. Google, again, seeing large profits, and like $17.2 billion in line with expectations. But the thing that the stock market liked about that was that that is an 11% year-on-year growth, which is expected. But what they really liked is a 2% decline in costs and expenses. Aren't you excited about that, G?
Yeah, I don't think I would be if I'm one of the people who were fired, or however they achieved 2%.
That's what makes the money men excited. 2% reduction in overall expenses. They were very happy with Google. And Microsoft also doing pretty well, to be quite honest. People reporting that they're better than expected fourth quarter performance from last year. Their strength is becoming in the cloud, where I think the future of a lot of business is going to be heading and is already in. Their cloud-based platform, the Azure, is competing very well with Amazon's AWS. And their phones are completely rocketed out the market, obviously. Nobody's interested in Lumia anymore. They've written off Nokia. But I think we'll see the re-emergence of the Surface phone with the Windows operating system building into the whole Surface ecosystem. And that was certainly a popular release last year.
Just, can I jump in and ask, if they've written off Nokia, and Nokia used to be the main income for Finland, does that mean that Microsoft just wrote off Finland?
I'd like to think that there was more going on in Finland than just Nokia, but hey, you know, you might have had a point.
I don't think reindeers make that much money.
No. And finally on the news front, Intel.
Yeah, did you catch the Intel presentation yesterday?
No, I am a working man and was therefore relying on a sharp-eyed citizen such as yourself to pass on said news to moi.
I should probably say, when we say yesterday, that's yesterday, as we record a little bit early, but a few days ago for people who listen to it. Intel had a little presentation about their new technology, and they were talking about fancy things like spintronics and tunneling transistors.
Ooh, I'm excited already.
Yeah, well, as a gamer, I'm not sure you're going to be, because what they basically came out and said, look, things are going to be cooler, as in colder CPUs. But things are also going to be slower because they need to do completely new retooling. Yes.
No. Don't you make my CPU slower? How am I going to do my flipping gigahertz willy waving at anybody if they make my CPU slower?
Oh, poor you.
Oh, no. I presume that us old timers with big old PCs will be catered for, and that these new small cooler chips are being aimed at the mobile market. Would I be right in assuming that such stuff?
Well, I think we'll probably see these new ones first go to actually server farms where they just keep a shit ton of CPUs. You know, like Facebook and Google have warehouses just full of computers. That's where they will go in first.
I see.
But yeah, laptops, cell phone, tablets, that's also where we're going to see them. And eventually on the desktop, but I'm sure Intel will keep around their old technology that they made however many gigahertz fast, so that nerds like you still can have them.
Yes, I need my gigahertz. They are important to me. They are.
Well, and I'm saying this on a 3-point-something gigahertz Apple, so yeah, guess I'm also there.
Yeah, you are. You nerd, you.
Well, other than that, Intel's just saying, well, we're going to make more stuff and fancier stuff and cooler stuff. And hey, how can we complain?
No, I'll go along with that. I'm all for new tech. Just don't make it slow. That's all I ask.
Well, slow for starters. Later on, they'll probably catch up.
Yeah, I'm sure they will. now we've come to the actual end of our news items. What follows here is a final goodbye to something very dear to all our hearts. And I shall let Bam take it away.
Hi there, this is Daniel Maslovsky from Craneballs, and you're listening to Bammsters Rated R Podcast.
Good evening. My name is Booker DeLuca, and I am a dust player.
My name is Dalmont Legrand, and I was a Dust 514 player.
And my name is Corin. I played Dust 514.
Alright, my name is Ferris Thev. I played Dust 514.
My name is G-Talk. I played Dust since before it was released.
Hi, I'm Stefan the Almighty. I'm a Dust player.
Hey, this is Marcelo Adele, longtime veteran of Dust 514.
Hello, I'm Jedek Menaheim. I played Dust since the early beta.
Hi, my name's Slay Ashes. I'm a Dust 514 mercenary.
I remember when you could take the dropship, smash people, and then you had people repairing the dropships at the same time. That was fun.
A dropship had flown in low, and then it was taking out people with the turret, and I run up, jump over the railing, and jump onto the dropship. I was able to place down enough REs, and it exploded.
And Stefan was screaming to this guy, come on, fucking reps. And this guy's saying, I am repping you, I am repping you, I am repping you. And he's like, no, you fucking not. So Stefan turns around and the guy's carrying a nano hive.
I remember that one, actually. It was Jolly Roger trailing Steph and giving him ammunition instead of giving him reps. Steph was so pissed off, man. Yeah, I remember a time when I just freshly forged gun, judged what it meant was out of a dropship with a friend of mine, Snagman. Seemingly from nowhere, Zeke jumps out with his plasma cannon and fires a round off. Bang! On the kill feed, you just notice Judge Redimentus killed by a plasma cannon. And Zeke just shouts across the battlefield, nice catch, asshole! And you see in the kill feed, Judge Redimentus has left the battlefield. Good game, man. Good game.
Friendships were forged in this virtual battlefield.
Well, you know, it's very sad that Dust is going to be closed.
I'm sad to see Dust finally go.
I'm pretty disappointed about Dust 514 being shut off.
It'd be sad to see it go.
I enjoyed it.
Hopefully they do better with the next game.
This is me signing off for a final time.
A new chapter ends and a new one begins.
I have to say it is with deep regret that I finally face the fact that I will never ever see a digital tree in Dust 514. R.I.P.
I'm Daniel Maslovsky from Craneballs, and this is a procedurally generated Rated R episode.
Right, guys, welcome back. Welcome back to the interview for Planet Nomads, a game that's currently launching on Kickstarter. We have here for you the community developer. So please bear in mind, the guy is from the Czech Republic. His second language is English, so just give him a few. Just give him a few. He's trying to translate a very loudmouth South African and go from there. So guys, right, I have here with me my bestest wingman, Grit Breather. Grit, say hi.
Hi, Bam. Hi, everyone, and everybody say hello to Daniel Maslovsky from Craneballs.
Hello, everyone. It's good to be here. Thanks for having me.
Right, Daniel Maslovsky. I'm just going to call you Daniel M because I can see my tongue slipping and saying something very, very bad. Dude, please tell me about yourself. Who is the Daniel Maslovsky?
You're doing fine with the surname. So Daniel is how old am I? I'm almost 30 years old now. I've joined Craneballs about 3.5 years ago. And we're located in the Czech Republic in Ostrava, which is a third biggest city in Czech Republic, but it's still relatively slow. And I had no idea that games were being made here. So entering the office for the first time felt a little like entering Google because everybody was kind of mad here, riding around on these little bikes. It was just a dream come true because I've been a gamer since I was 12 years old. something like that with first Doom and Duke Nukem, really, or shooter games. I was having nightmares from that. And it was straight after university, and that was it. And the guys still took me in, and 3.5 years later, we're making our first PC game. So it was quite a ride.
Yes, your first PC game, Planet Nomads. Daniel, please tell us about Planet Nomads.
So Planet Nomads is a sci-fi sandbox game. You are stranded on a procedurally generated planet, and your only way out of this mess is to build useful things and progress further in the game, which means exploring your surrounding and not getting eaten, frozen to the star, and generally being in a very bad spot.
That sounds like an interesting game, Daniel. How do you get to the idea of that?
Well, it's been a closed meeting with our co-founders, but I know that one of them has been he's an avid sci-fi freak, but one of the old kinds, I mean, like Arthur C. Clarke and Tim White is his inspiration for his visual thing. And he wanted to do a space adventure long time before Planet Nomad. The other co-founder, he's into mini cars, and he wanted something with building, and Martin, our CEO, said like, yeah, let's put it together in a sandbox game.
All right, Daniel, sweet. What do you specifically do for Planet Nomad? What is your job title?
So the job title is, the official one is marketing and community guy. But it's not only that, it's basically anything that has to do with English, that's me. So I will be writing the blog, I will be writing all the text for the game, I will be writing Kickstarter page, preparing the script for the video that we did there. Also, so basically any kind of communication with our studio, with Craneballs, is going through me. What I tend to say, like, getting on the side of players, so every time the developers say, or the coders, the engineers say, like, this is not possible, I do my best to persuade them that if they try real hard, we could probably do that. So I'm defending our players' rights, because if they are not happy on the first line of defense on our side, so yeah, I try to please them as much as I can, but everybody on the team wants that.
Right, so you're basically the community manager that holds up gamers' rights to the developers. Awesome, dude. Brilliant, brilliant, brilliant.
Well, I'd even say he's the Planet Nomads ambassador, going both ways.
Yes, I'd go there as well, dude. I'd go there as well.
I'll gladly take the title. It's a nice one.
So, Daniel, you mentioned Kickstarter, and you just recently started a Kickstarter campaign for Planet Nomads. How did you get to Kickstarter, and how's that going?
Well, so the original idea was to put our vision together and get it on Kickstarter as soon as possible to get feedback from players, or basically to ask the question, is this a game you would like to play, and get feedback on that. So that was the original idea, but then the development grew up to a team of 10 people, and it blew out of proportions as it usually does with Craneballs, and now we are so emotionally invested into this project that whatever happens at Kickstarter, we are not going to back out. But even though that would mean trying to get funding, like external funding, and we would like to not go that way and to stay independent as we are right now.
Okay, cool. So it's basically a way for the community and your future gamers to tell you, keep doing this.
Exactly that. And besides measuring the reactions of the community to Planet Nomads, we also wanted to reach out to them. So we started with a website, then we went to indie database, and every step like that was growing Planet Nomads bigger and bigger. We even got voted, Planet Nomads got voted best upcoming indie of 2015. I mean, it was a huge reminder that we are onto something, and we should really focus hard on that. And now Kickstarter is coming. We are halfway there right now, and we had a great start with the community we created. We're hoping to get there eventually.
But yeah, that sounds cool about the Kickstarter, and I know I've funded it. So listeners, if you haven't yet funded Planet Nomads, go do it now. There's a lot of competition out there, such as Space Engineers and Imperium Galactic. And I know there are some also really good games coming out for procedural generated stuff like No Man's Sky. And why would people go with Planet Nomads with all these things to pick from?
I honestly believe it's the combination of the three aspects, which is building and survival and exploration, because they all three are tied together and equally important for the game. That's really what it is. I mean, for building, I don't have the patience to be making nice stuff. And like really going, spending 2 days building something just for the sake of building. So what I like about Planet Nomads is that anything you build can be or is used for something, can be used for something useful, can put you on different places on the planet and can get you not killed during exploration, and it really gives you the edge that you need to survive out there.
Okay, Daniel, do tell me, Craneballs, the name, why? Because I've got an image of that Transformer robot Megatron thing with dangling testicles as wrecking balls, climbing a pyramid in Egypt somewhere. Why Craneballs, bro?
All right, so you put the two together, okay. That'll be really hard coming out of it, so...
Put the two together!
Basically, I have no idea. I mean, our co-founders probably were sitting somewhere refreshing themselves and thought, like, we need something that is easy to say, that has a ring to it, and that's gonna create noise. And Craneballs is what happened. And I was always hoping, like, with the bird being in our logo, that it has something to do with Wrecking Ball and the crane, the lovely bird. But testicles do come up quite often in communication with our fans. So there you have it.
Yeah.
Sorry, I had to ask that question. I'm so sorry. So enough about the testicle jokes, dude. Who the company? You know, who the team? Do tell. What previous platforms have you been on? That sort of stuff.
So the team started with the three co-founders, obviously, who had absolutely no background in game development in 2008. They were doing web design and didn't want to anymore. They were really fed up with customers telling them to, can you make this green a little bit more greener or bluer? So App Store opened at that time. We didn't have iPhones back then. I mean, the company didn't have one. So they cut out a cardboard piece that would simulate the size of the screen available at that time and created Blimp. And then 2 years later, Overkill, which was a simple gallery shooter and our first free-to-play game, and it just exploded. It was millions of downloads in the first couple of days. It was number one on the US overall chart, and things got really big from there. We were gradually growing from, there was 5 or 6 people by then, and then we moved to this current office. There's now 20 of us, and we've been making mobile games for 7 years, and this, now Planet Nomads, our first PC game.
Okay, enough about Spaceballs. No, wait, hang on. That's not Spaceballs. Craneballs and Planet Nomads. Dude, please, bacon and beer question in time. Please, bro. Bacon, did you eat it? What do you want served with it? How'd you like it served? And what beer do you want to accompany it?
I love bacon for its many... It's a magical part of my cuisine, so to speak. It's always in the kitchen because it can stay fresh for a long time. And I use it in pretty much all my cooking. It's not much, all right. It's fried eggs with bacon. I'm trying to emulate full English breakfast all the time with beans and, yeah, that's it, and tomatoes. Then it goes into spaghetti as well, fried on a pan, and it goes to a risotto. It's an Italian, like, with rice and bacon together. And it works all the time, it never fails, and I love bacon for that. And for beer, I was drinking a local one called Radegast, which is a strong name, but recently I've switched to Pilsner Urquell, which is made in Pilsen.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but Radegast, or Radegast, was a ancient god who actually invented beer, was he not?
Oh my, you have a better history background than I do. Right you are, he was a pagan god who, and I think it's mentioned that he did invent beer. If it's true or not, I don't know, but he has a big statue on the top of our biggest mountain here, which is, okay, only 1900 meters high, but he's there with a big 10 meter statue.
I think I'm gonna go visit the guy and pay my beer tribute because he invented beer in my books. Yes.
Yeah, Bam, this sounds like the place for you. They love bacon and they have a mountain god who invented beer.
Dude, I'm moving to the Czech Republic tomorrow.
And if I tell you that beer is about £1 or €1, would that even make it even sweeter for you?
Yes. When can I immigrate to the Czech Republic? Yes, I'm going there now.
We'll be waiting for you.
Seriously, €1? Dude,
seriously, unless you are in Prague where it will be 3 or 4 because they like to get that from tourists who have no idea it normally costs €1. But anywhere else than Prague and it's like that.
Right, I tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to book my next holiday down to where you are and you can take me around to the mountain of Radagast and we can pay homage to the god of beer. Damn right. Fucking damn right. This is going to be sweet.
Bam right. You got beard to go with a beer?
I do have a beard, yes.
Then it's settled.
Done.
Wait, Bam, but don't you also need to go to Iceland to the night festivities of Ham?
I do, yes, but I've also got to go to the Penis Museum in Reykjavik as well, and I'm not too keen on going there just yet.
Takes balls.
Craneballs, damn right.
So enough of that beer, bacon, and culture stuff. Let's get back to gaming questions. So Daniel, lots of other games that are similar to Planet Nomads. I've run into all sorts of different technical problems with implementing stuff like realistic physics that you're going to have and large worlds, multiplayer stuff, procedural generation. Have you already run into a few of these?
Yeah, quite a couple actually. Because with Planet Nomads, we started on a flat planet because we didn't think we would have space travel at first, but it became a thing quite quickly. So we switched to spherical planets. And if you combine that with building, it creates some problems, mostly because if you do a tower that is already like 10 meters long or something, you can't connect those two because they are at an angle to each other. So we came up with a grid for that. As you mentioned, physics, that's true. The main coder for physics, always consulting his supervisor at the university. And there's one thing with Unity, but I think it's every game is like that. It's like in every procedurally generated world, you have a center of the world, so to speak. And the further you get away from that, things start to get messy. I mean, procedural generation starts to behave differently. Animals start to flying, buildings don't hold together. And so we had to figure this one out as well. And basically ended up with like anything you can see is constantly going closer to the center of the universe, so to speak. So even though you don't see that, that's happening in the background.
Cool, so it sounds like you have come across the floating point monster and slayed it.
That's what we did.
So you actually move the world instead of moving the player. So you already have one component of Planet Nomads out called the editor, and it's free download. It's available from the Kickstarter and from your site. What are you expecting from this? What do people do with it?
So when we released it some time ago, it was all about, there were like basically three things we wanted to achieve with that. It was because survival and building games have this bad aura about them, so we wanted to release something tangible to show that we know what we're doing and we can deliver. And it's a demo of the building part of the game, so we wanted people to download it, start building things, show us what they've built. And mostly it was also about trying to get feedback on what feels right, what feels wrong. So we wanted to see what can be created with that. We wanted to show that we know how to create a building game and wanted to use it to improve building in Planet Nomads in the end.
Planet Nomads is scheduled to be released to alpha testers in late 2016 and then early access on Steam in early 2017. What will these two versions include?
Yeah, it's a little bit too early to say that, and we wouldn't want to spoil the surprise, would we?
Well, that depends. I wouldn't mind the surprise being spoiled, but I do understand.
Right. Daniel. Dude. Bro. We at Bammsters Podcast here are very big fans of VR. We are VR nutters. Do you have any VR support for Planet Nomads?
It is planned. We have a VR. We have Oculus here at the office. We tried some basic things. And right now we know that when you move your head, you will be moving the player view and not the whole player. So that's one thing we want to do. And when is that coming? That depends.
Right, Daniel, dude. Last question from me. I've noticed on the roadmap of Planet Nomads that you guys are going to be developing something for consoles. Is this true?
Yep. So we've been experimenting with Xbox, as we have the dev console in here. Sony is still waiting to be boarded, but we're sure it's coming. And if the stretch goal for consoles is reached, then it'll be a top priority.
Cool. So bam, it sounds like you can actually play this.
Yay! Console peasants can play! Yay! As long as the stretch goal's met, I'm sure.
Well, go and back the project.
I already have, dude. Whilst we're talking to the guy, I have backed the project. Yay, me! Right, guys, that is all the questions we have for Daniel Maslovsky. I hope I said that right. Yeah, from, I think I did. Awesome. Anyway, guys,
close enough.
That's it. That's close enough, yeah. That's it for me, guys. Thank you very much. Cheers, bye!
And for me, everybody, speak to you next time. Goodbye to Daniel as well.
All right, thanks. Thanks for the questions. I answered them as best as I could, and I hope we can do this again.